Hello and Assalamualaikum. Good day, everyone. My name is Dr. Wan Nurul Nadiah, a senior lecturer from School of Fisheries and Aquaculture Sciences, University Malaysia, Terengganu. Today, we will have a closer look on live feed management in aquaculture. These natural foods are essential components needed by the fish larvae. We will dive into different sections in live feed management, which are zooplankton for larviculture, types of zooplankton, copepods culture, moina and defnia culture, artemia culture, and rotifer culture. For zooplankton for larviculture, in short, let's start learning on the types of food for fish babies. We call this production of natural foods known as live feed production for the early stages of fish larvae. Zooplankton constitutes the bulk of the staple food of different fish species in natural habitats. As a live feed, zooplankton is referred resources with high quality lipid, fatty acid and protein, which are essential for the growth and survival of the fish larvae. There are many types of zooplankton and microalgae species which acts as a living capsule for fish larvae nutrition. There are many types of zooplankton and microalgae species which acts as a living capsule for fish larvae nutrition. There are different types of zooplankton made available for fish larvae. The types of zooplankton usually cultured for larval feeding are copepods, cladocerans, rotifers and brine shrimps. First, we are going to talk about copepods culture. In general, there are three major copepod groups, which are calanoids, harpaticoids and cyclopods. Most often, members of these groups are found within the shallow, sunlight-photic zone where they graze heavily on phytoplankton. They are in turn preyed upon by all sorts of creatures ranging from tiny fishes to whales. As such, they form an important link in most freshwater and marine ecosystems, being a natural and in many cases vital food source for varied marine organisms. It is not surprising that they are cultured for use in the aquarium and aquaculture industries. Species representing each of these three groups have been utilized successfully for these purposes. Calanoids are mainly barrel-shaped, herbivorous, and most often live and entirely planktonic. Among the three major groups, calanoids are the largest in physical size, while harpaticoids have an elongate body shape, primarily living on benthic habitats and heavily detritivores. Furthermore, cyclopods are pear-shaped body and has a well-developed first antenna and are omnivores and completely pelagic. Copepod's culture system consists of copepods are usually reared using a batch culture system where first the wild samples were collected from marine or freshwater ecosystems using a plankton net of 200 micron mesh size, and the samples were transported to laboratory for upscaling as stock culture. Next, the stock cultures are maintained in 100 to 200 liter outdoor culture tanks with continuous aeration and fed with microalgae. The cultures are maintained and the eggs, normally adults, were separated and put into fresh culture tanks every week. Throughout the culture process, copepods were fed with microalgae diets such as tetrasalmis, chetocheros and isochrysis species. The fertilized eggs hatch into a larvae called a nauplia. This is the steps in copepod life cycle. Nauplias will then undergo a series of moocs before changing into a copepodite stage. Next, copepodite will undergo six further moocs before becoming a sexually mature adult. Next, we go to cladoceran. Now, we move to another types of fish baby food known as Cladoceran. Cladoceran comprises of two common species of Daphnia and Moina. Firstly, Daphnia are small planktonic crustaceans with size ranges from 0.2 to 5 mm and commonly known as water fleas. In contrast, Moina is half the maximum length of Daphnia with the size ranges from 0.1 to 0.4 mm and the difference between Moina and Daphnia is the structures of the brood pouch. The brood pouch is completely closed for Daphnia and open for Moina species. For Cladoceran life cycle, under normal condition, the population of Cladoceran consists of all females. They produce 4 to 22 broods per female via a sexual reproduction and the broods are produced every 1.5 to 2 days. Cladocerans of Moina and Daphnia species are able to reproduce at 4 to 7 days of age. However, under adverse environmental condition, males are being produced. Sexual reproduction occurs and resting eggs are also produced. The diapause stage is known as epiphia. For Cladoceran culture system, Moina and Daphnia can be produced either in combination with their food or as separate cultures. Combined culture is the simplest, but production from separate cultures has been reported to be higher in terms of the amount of production in a mass culture. The culture system comprises of microalgae tanks as food for the cladocerans, as well as separate tanks of Moina and Daphnia culture tanks. The cladocerans are usually collected using plankton nets before being fed to fish fry. For rotifer culture, now let us focus on rotifers. The common species of rotifers are Branchionus plicatilis and Branchionus rotundiformis, where both are marine species and there is another freshwater species which is Branchionus calyciflorus. For rotifer life cycle, consists of amiotic and mictic. Now, let us talk about the life cycle of rotifers. There are two modes of reproduction in rotifer. During female parthenogenesis, the amiotic females produce amiotic, which is a diploid, with 2N chromosomes, eggs, which develop and hatch into amiotic females. In contrast, under adverse environmental conditions, females switch to sexual reproduction, resulting in mictic and amictic females. Males are present during these conditions. They are much smaller than the females, have no feeding structures, and only live for a day. Rotifer culture system. Rotifer are easy to culture and can be operated at a minimal cost. Stock cultures were prepared and once the population has increased, rotifers were transferred to a semi-continuous culture tanks. In this system, sterilized seawater is being used and usually 10 to 15% of rotifers were harvested daily for enrichment procedures. Yeast and microalgae are the common food for rotifers. Each tank in the semi-continuous culture was operated for up to 10 days before being harvested fully for new culture setup. As for Artemia culture, next, we move to the very common live feed used in larval rearing known as Artemia or brine shrimp. Artemia can be used instantly where it can be hatched from dormant seeds. Two common species of Artemia widely used in larviculture are Artemia salina and Artemia franciscana. Brine shrimp are also known as sea monkeys.
Thank you.
For the life cycle of Artemia, whether baby branch shrimp hatch from a cyst or are born live, in its first free swimming period, it is called a nauplius or larva. The rate at which it develops through the rest of the stages in its life cycle is affected by salinity, water temperature, and food availability. Artemia cysts are metabolically inactive and do not further develop as long as they are kept dry. Upon immersion in seawater, the cysts hydrate, and after 20 hours, the outer membrane of the cyst bursts and the free swimming nauplii or larva is born. The larva grows and differentiates through about 15 molts, which took around 1 to 3 weeks. Adult Artemia have an elongated body after 4 to 5 weeks. Fertilized eggs in female brood pouch will develop into a free swimming nauplii, or also known as ovoviviparous reproduction. For Artemia indirect hatching method, firstly, the electronic scale is used to measure 2 grams of Artemia. Next, 1 liter of salt water will place in an aluminium flask that contains the Artemia cyst. Aeration is provided to the flask and incubated for 18 hours until the cysts are hatched. After 18 hours, the Artemia was siphoned out from the flask by using a plankton net. 10 liters of salt water were filtered using a plankton net and poured into the culture tanks. The siphoned Artemia were then put into the culture tanks with gentle aeration, and Artemia were fed with microalgae. For Artemia decapsulation technique using bleach, first, dried Artemia need to be placed in a conical flask and hydrated with tap water at room temperature. A hypochlorite solution will be added to the flask, and the color will observe from brown to gray and lastly change to orange. Next, when the cysts have turned to 90% orange, the cysts were siphoned using the plankton net, and any residual chlorine will be neutralized by transferring the plankton net to a clean beaker and pour 3 liters of 1.0% sodium thiosulfate into the net. Next, the cysts need to be soaked in the sodium thiosulfate solution for 1 minute, and lastly, the cysts were rinsed with dechlorinated tap water. The cysts are now safe to be stocked into the culture tanks, and gentle aeration were provided. Applications for feeding regime in larval fish: normally, rotifers and copepod nauplii were provided in the early stages of fish larvae, which is from 3 to 20 days post-hatch or DPH. Copepodite stages of copepods were fed by fish larvae from 20 to 35 DPH, and the common copepod species used are Tigropus, Paracalanus species, Akatia species, Oitona species. During these larval phases, Artemia and minch fish or formulated feed can also be provided as a feed source for fish larvae. We now come to the end of this topic. Let's summarize today's lesson. As the conclusion, zooplankton is a very reliable natural food source for fish larvae. It is essential to understand the culture protocols of potential live feed species in order to obtain a successful production of zooplankton mass culture. The necessary information guided from this learning session can directly assist the understanding on live feed culture, types, nutrition, and the life cycle from each zooplankton species. That's all for today. I hope you enjoy and can utilize all the information provided in this video. Have a good day and see you again next time. Thank you so much.